Hello there, Marshall here from Limited Resources. We're jumping into another cube. This is Vintage Cube here with you on Channel Fireball. Hi, how are you? It's nice to see you. Glad you decided to join me. I've got a Mox, which we're obviously going to take. I mean, I don't know. Like, this is a reason I think why if when push comes to shove, I think I actually prefer Legacy Cube to Vintage Cube, which is a little weird. But this is part of the reason why. Like, this, it's a Mox. It's sweet. It's nice, but it's just not interesting, right? Like, I could take Vampiric Tutor. I love Ashiok in the cube. Like, there's so many cool cards I could take here, but I really am kind of forced to take the Mox, which to me is a lot like taking a land, you know, like a basic land. And I'm going to take Mind Twist here. Now, that's a fun one. These packs have been stacked, though. Ooh. Easily my favorite ramp payoff in the entire cube, Ulamog the Ceaseless Hunger. Let's just take it and see if we can't put together some ramp. There's a lot of times where you pick up the artifacts or the green creatures and you can just sort of make it go, hello. Primeval Titan, super powerful. And this pack is really bad except for it. So I guess Strix is fine. But yeah. Prime time. Get in there. Prime time into Ulamog. GG. See, we've already got a game plan. What could possibly go wrong? Okay, Verdant, or should I just take the Sylvan Caryatid here? Yeah, probably so. We just have so many sweet ramp payoffs, and while a two-drop one isn't really my favorite, Hexproof is nice. It means it doesn't usually, I mean, it's hard to kill it, and it does make black mana as well, in case we end up splashing, let's say, or whatever. Because a lot of times you end up with blue. I should say, a lot of times I end up with blue because, well, it's the best color in the cube by a lot. All right, Arbor Elf. Fine. More ramp. Man, that's really what we need anyway, so sure. Yeah. Green Sun Zenith. Get in there, buddy. We've already got a few things we can search up with it, so that's nice. Ooh, Devoted Druid or Birds. This is interesting. So I actually really like Devoted Druid. I mean, it's pretty busted. It, you know, for a turn, it'll add two mana, which is, it turbos out stuff. You know, it gets you over the hump to get cast cards like this. But Birds of Paradise, extremely strong and can cast black for Mind Twist as well. Yeah, I guess I'll take the bop. I am very partial to Devoted Druid, but come on. Come on. Look at that thing. Devoted Druid does not have rainbow feathers. Mishra's Workshop, not really doing much here, even though it's the most busted card. I'll just take him in case we end up green, black. Maybe I could play a him. I'm not the biggest fan, but I'll play it. This is what I like to do. If I'm going to get him, I want to get him. We should make a list of the most devastating cube plays. Definitely Mind Twist, your hand is on it. Ooh, Sylvan Library, yes, please. Sylvan Library's nice. Okay, I actually like Imperial Seal. That to me is a very nice pickup. It's not an amazing card. Remember, it puts it on top of your library, so it sets you up for the next turn rather than being like card advantage or even card neutral, but it is powerful. I mean, it does get you what you need. And, you know, a lot of times in a cube, you can just have a bunch of cards that draw the card immediately. So you, like, put it on top and then draw your card with, you know, some spell or whatever. And then you can cast it or set it up. Reggie? Not really Reggie, though. It's kind of like new Reggie. Wilderness Wrecked? Sorcery. Yeah, no, I'm going to take Smokestack, but probably not play it. Wall of Blossoms. Yeah, that actually might make the cut even. That will not. All right, what do we got? Metalworker. Garrick. Avacyn's Pilgrim. Garrick. I like Garrick a lot. And I also think Garrick's underrated in the cube by a little bit. All right. Let's see what we got here. There we go. Garrick can do some really stupid stuff besides being a double ramp spell and also effectively only costing two mana once you are at four mana or above, which is really powerful. You can steal wins, right? Garrick plus go on my turn, overrun, you're dead. That happens. Ooh, Karn Daddy, I like that. Thoughtseize is really good too, but I really like Karn as a payoff, as a ramp payoff. There's Oracle. Time Twister is kind of interesting, but I'm going to take Oracle here. And then the other thing, though, is that Garrick lets you do cool stuff with lands. So, like, for example, I had a play in the cube where I played Sheldock Isle, hit something big, but it was tapped, had a Garrick in play, untapped it, and then activated it right away. Like, that's a thing you can do. If you're lucky enough and you get, one of the super, super powerful lands, like in for our deck, it would be Cradle, right? Tap it, untap it, tap it. I mean, you end up getting 10 mana out of one land or something for the turn if you have Garrick. So, yeah, I think that he has some hidden power in cubes like this where you can power him out early, you get a discount, and then he can kind of go nuts. Wurmcoil, Shriekma, fine, I guess. I haven't really seen anything that's really made me want to go into another color. I'm just going to take Surge. It's another good one-drop mana accelerator, effectively. Stuff to do on turn one is really important in cubes as well. The decks that I have that have a lot to do on turn one tend to play really well. They don't always win, but like they play out well when I'm playing out the games, and I always feel like I'm in there and have a good shot. And the ones that don't tend to be more powerful, which makes sense, right? If your average converted mana cost is higher, you're probably playing with more powerful cards, but you don't get to play as many of them. And that's just how that works. Ooh, Fallen Shinobi, I love you. But yeah, we're going to take Llanowar Elves, all the mana, all the time. Finale of Devastation is interesting. We could also take Breeding Pool in case we end up in any blue, but we still have it. I mean, blue's being cut from both directions. So I guess I take Finale. I don't really like it that much, to be honest. I'm more of a tooth and nail type of person. Ink Eyes, not so much either. I could take Vraskil Golgari Queen. Destroy target non-land permanent. There are a ton of those. And I'm leaning towards being in black. I feel like we're just mono green. Like, I don't think I'm going to run him, but I'll probably run Mind Twist and then maybe Imperial Seal. All right, we'll take Vraska. All right, Tireless Tracker, I love. Shaldred, I also love. And then Biogenic Ooze has also impressed. This is a very powerful card. It's a really quick clock. But I think I like Tireless Tracker better, so I'm going to take it. Also, we don't have any threes, and we've got Arbor Elf, Birds of Paradise, Llanowar Elf. So having a three that we can just slam down and start getting rolling is actually pretty powerful. All the elves. All right, this is a pack we open, and we still just get all the elves, just every one of them. So what do we need here? Well, we actually just need a little more raw power, so a little bit more up top, and then a little bit more right here, and we're good to go. A few things to do on turns three, with three or four mana, and then a couple of more things to do with 100 mana, basically, is where we want to be. Reanimate's interesting, but I think I just want Scavenging Ooze here. This card's just very good. It's kind of a jack of all trades. It's good against aggro. It's okay against control. It's very good against most combo decks because they tend to use the graveyard. Ooh, Corpse Dance. Okay. We'll take that just as a possible thing. Hissing Quagmire or Beast Within? I actually feel like I want Beast Within, even though Hissing Quagmire is probably decent in a deck like this. But yeah, Beast Within is kind of a catch-all. Assassin's Trophy is too. All right, well, we wheeled the Finale, so we didn't even have to pay. All right, let's get some sweet stuff out of pack three. This deck could be amazing if we get some of the good mid-range payoffs, and if we solidify a second color a little bit too. Oh, yeah, baby. That's the one. Hoof'em. Perfect. Good God. Asked and received. Oh my God, and we got Gaia's Cradle. Cube. Garrick, Basalt Monolith. I'm going to take Basalt Monolith, although we are like loaded up on mana. Treachery is probably the best card here. I could take treachery, just kill Seal him, and try to make Mind Twist work because it's so powerful. I'm just going to go for the Basalt Monolith. I think we're good. Wow, we got Channel. Sure. I wish I could take that Emrakul as well, because we do want one more big colorless threat now. But since we're almost mono green, we can also channel Green Sun Zenith and get this or this. I mean, we obviously have channel Ulamog GG. All right, what do we got? A Signet. Polukranos, I'm not a big fan of. Finks, whatever. I mean, we don't really need more mana than what we have. All right, Mindslaver's nice. Mindslaver's a good place to put a bunch of mana. Fastbond's cool, but we don't have any draw sevens, so I'm just going to take Mindslaver. Oh, but we did have Oracle. Ugh. Oracle Fastbond is stupid. Oh, well. Jeez. We are like the only green drafter at this freaking thing. Look at the elves. We got Arbor Elf, Avacyn's Pilgrim, Birds of Paradise, Finhorn Elf, Draga Tree Speaker, Llanowar Elves. Like, unbelievable. This for the board? Yeah. Yeah, just more mana. I could take Hangar Backwalker. I really don't like it that much, though. I'd rather just take this. I'm just really not a big Hangar Back fan. Huge fan of Walking Ballista, but Hangar Back not so much. I don't think I want that, right? Do I want this? Do I want Finale? Maybe I just do. Probably not. I do like Garrick. I don't want Vraska or him. Or probably Imperial Seal. Maybe just Mind Twist. Maybe not. Maybe I just mono green. This card's pretty good against us. Okay, I guess I don't need the mana, so I'll just take Polukranos in case we run into like a creature, like a mono white deck or something. Because that thing has a good brick wall for that type of strategy. Yeah, we're the only green drafter. Just at the entire table. Unbelievable. Vivian probably is actually worth playing. It's weird because her ability, the destroy target artifact, enchantment, or creature with flying, is like super relevant in this cube. It almost always kills something that you're quite happy. And if not, you're just loading up, right? I probably need this type of card to kind of fuel the fire, because I've got only a few card draw type cards if I'm going to be mono green. I really, really want to play Mind Twist, but what am I doing? Like, what can I use? Okay, so maybe I can play it. I've got Sylvan, and I've got Birds. I did not end up somehow with the elf that makes black mana, or a Signet that makes black mana. So I could probably do, like, one Swamp and then just try to find those. That's got to be worth it. I could even do a few Swamps. I mean, I need green, but, like, and I can search it up with this. Yeah, for sure. Okay, so that's in. Don't need Wall. Tracker is a good source of card advantage. Deranged Hermit probably can go, but it's nice with Cradle and with Hoof. So maybe I can just keep it. Dude, this deck is so sweet. Oh my god. I think I can probably kill Simic Signet, actually. I have so much other stuff to ramp. Search for Tomorrow finds it. Man, it just keeps getting better. That one Swamp is just like the best card all of a sudden. I'll kill Beast Within. I need to get one more card out of here, I think. I don't want to play 15 lands. I want to play 16, so 15 and a Pearl. Could cut Scavenging Ooze to kick things off, or probably my worst elf is Arbor Elf. Let's just do that. I've got so much mana ramp, it's not like I'm short. Okay, I have to run the awkward Mox Pearl, but it's still worth it. And then, yeah, just the one Swamp. This deck is so sweet, it does not even fit on the screen. Wow. I think I'm in love. Okay, so let's see how this thing does. I guess I should take a screenshot here too, because I do have some ways to search. I wonder if I want Finale. That is actually the card I didn't ever come down on. So I can just get any creature. So on 3 mana, I can get one of these, which is bad. On 4 mana, I can get one of these, which is bad. On 5, yeah, it just doesn't really add up right. My best play is win the game with Craterhoof or get Primeval Titan if I don't have anything else to do. But I already have Green Sun Zenith, so yeah, I'm just going to play it like this. All right, so I want to remind you that this video is brought to you by channelfireball.com. If you would like to sell your cards, that's right, you've got that pile of rares sitting there that you don't really need anymore, and you'd like to turn it into some money, or if you want to trade it in for more cards or whatever it is that you need from CFB, they'll give you 30% bonus on trade-in for store credit, or you can just get the money straight up. That's channelfireball.com/buylist to check the prices and see if there's something you might want to sell. Let's get into the action. Hey, look, it's an elf. No, the super elf. All right, well, they didn't follow it up with anything, so at least I have that. Dang, Devoted Druid plus Emery? At least they bricked. Wow, Plains Oko? What the? That's weird. Fortunately, I don't have a play this turn. Don't mind me. Next turn, I get to do stuff. I get to play Vivian, blow up Sol Ring, probably. Wait, they can just play it back, right? Choose target artifact card in your graveyard. You may cast it. Yeah, so that doesn't actually do anything. I mean, casting Vivian's fine, but... just 7 mana. Yeah, no problem. What could possibly... God. So now I have to trade Vivian Reed for Battlesphere, and they're still going to have a slew of tokens left over. But the next turn, I get to cast Primeval Titan and then eventually Ulamog. In fact, quite shortly after that, Ulamog. So this is actually not the worst. So they can recast the Battlesphere, but it takes like all of their mana, right? Oh, they actually can't without a land either. Teferi. Okay, I was going to say, I don't think I care about Teferi. I really care about Teferi because of this. Well, so next turn I go Basalt Monolith, Jiraga Tree Speaker, your move. They pound me. What just happened? Oh, they just regrowth the battle? Well, you already had a regrowth. What the heck? That was weird. Oh, I drew channel. So now I can just cast Ulamog this turn. Exiling Emery and Sol Ring. That leaves 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 mana, and that thing's going to be stuck in hand. Wow. Incredible. So I do want to get this Tree Speaker down, and maybe Basalt Monolith. I don't know if I have enough mana to do every little thing, though. Maybe I just want to get that in Primeval Titan. Can I spend 14 mana here, or 14 life? Definitely need to get this down. Kaboom. So if I spend 4 more, I'll be at 3. I'll have 2 blockers. So if one of them goes away, I lose the game. Yeah, that is not acceptable. I can't do that. So I should actually have just gone to 8 then. I thought I might Basalt Monolith. That would put me down to 5, but I would have the Tree Speaker. That's probably worth it because that guarantees that I can cast the the Primeval Titan next turn, which seems important. Could have just exiled a land and just let Emery stay. I will snap block one of these mirrors. Easiest block of my life. No flyer, no flyer, no flyer. Okay, Thran Dynamo, you got it. Now what? Stonecoil Serpent for four. This is actually a very good draw. Okay, so I get Cradle and Swamp. So the question is, can I attack here? If I attack, I'll have a block here. And then I'll have a chump block here. So this has trample. So if they get rid of Primeval Titan, I lose the game. So I guess I can't attack. They only have one card. Like, what are they gonna do to get rid of Primeval Titan? There's a bunch of stuff, I suppose. Though I feel like I probably would have seen any way to interact here. Because the thing about attacking here is that I get in for 10. I also eat up a bunch of their library. And then they have to block this for the rest of the game. I can also play Garrick next turn and draw 10 cards. What happens if I just sit here, though? They get a little more time. Yeah, that's okay. I'm just going to sit. We are on the verge of just annihilating the rest of this game here. And if they just go like, oh, Oblivion Ring, it's like game over. So this is an issue, though. Like, I might need to trample over onto that. Okay, they have the Battle Sphere. We knew that. So we just lose if they get to attack with the Battle Sphere. Scavenging Ooze. Still not enough. So let's just draw a bunch of cards. Shoot, I don't think we're quite there. This thing just gets to trigger and just kill us. Okay, I can Garrick untap Cradle, but it's just not enough. I need more creatures. Scavenging Ooze can't quite eat enough. Because they can just tap all of these. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So I need to get to 7 life somehow. How many cards do I have? 9. So I could discard one of these to hand size. Only have one creature in the yard right now. God, I could do something crazy like Mind Twist myself. like play Scavenging Ooze, pay for Garrick, untap Swamp and Cradle. And try to mind twist four creatures and then still have four mana left over. I don't think it works. Just don't have enough mana. So I make five, I can make six mana. And if I discard this, this, if I do it for three and get those three, then yeah, I'm still just a mana short. I mean, I have to run absolutely perfect. I can get Sakura Tribe Elder into my yard, no problem. That's a guarantee. Maybe they'll block. Okay. Just too much. Even if I can get up to the requisite life total with Teferi out, if they, well, I guess I am attacking Teferi, so if they let this through, then Teferi won't be there, but yeah, I just don't see how I can get out of this. I'm gonna try for Mind Twist myself, float a bunch of green mana, and then eat up any creatures that go away. Because why not, right? Curious if they just single block here or if they throw away one of the mirror. Okay. Let's see what we get. Yeah, the forest went in. All right. And I guess we can take a look at what our opponent's dealing with here. And I should have obviously attacked the last turn. I just screwed that up completely. So I'm going to try to play a little tighter here, but let's see what our opponent's doing before they kill us. Ugin, Simic Signet, Elspeth, Monastery, Land Tax, really? Mana, so they have Mana Vault, Thran Dynamo, Oblivion Ring, Oko. They have a Day of Judgment. Holy crap. Yeah, this is just going to be rough. I just screwed this whole game up, though, by not attacking last turn with Ulamog. I just forgot how many cards he actually exiled. Why not attack with this? Okay. Yeah, come on. Get your head in the game here, Marsh. All right. Nature's Claim, yes. Beast Within, yes. War and Peace, no. I don't know what to cut. I guess I could cut like Mindslaver. Probably Mind Twist too. Like their deck is so fast with all that fast mana that it might not even be worth it to, because we're not really consistent with it anyway. Can't believe I did that. Yep. Okay, that I can deal with. Gimme, gimme, gimme. I'm hitting my land drop anyway. So I'll just go like this and then I'll get one land and actually I'll shuffle those away, which is good. Actually, wait, they're both on top. So I'll just get one right now. Get out of the way. There you go. And then the other one can go away. And I'll take some hits from Stonecoil Serpent, but I can deal with that. There's a lot worse things in the world than 4-4. Also, we're deftly playing around it by not having any multicolored. Oblivion Stone. Okay, well, I need to kind of build out my resources here then. Rampant we go, and then this happens. Ooh, Nature's Claim. Okay, so the question is, should I blow up Oblivion Stone? Or Soul Ring, or Stone Coil. If they blow up the world, how unhappy am I, really? Like, they blow up everything, they lose this and this, and then I still get to have Nature's Claim. I think it's actually fine if they do that. And they might go for like a play where they try to protect something with Oblivion Stone as well, in which case I can blow up Oblivion Stone. Yeah, they're just going to pass the turn back here. All right, let's see some lands. Jeez, what is going on? And then this is next, too. I need this, actually. just going to play this thing to try to kind of tempt them into popping the Oblivion Stone. Because now I think their plan is to put a fate counter on Stone Coil Serpent. And I'm just going to blow up the stone now. But I need to get that Sakura Tribe Elder so that I can shuffle away the jank on top of the library. This Stone Coil Serpent has been annoying enough that I can't just draw a bunch of cards off of the Sylvan Library as well. Ooh, hello. I will keep this guy, though. Okay, another Garrick. Start making some beasts. I'll trade off here. If they have a Wrath, which they haven't been playing any creatures, so it's not unlikely that they have a Wrath. I'd much, much rather have a Planeswalker left over. Aha, see? Look how smart I am. Okay, beast attack coming in. Double Garrick. Ooh, that's a nice one. And Oko? What is Oko going to do? Make one of them into a 3/3? Yeah, okay. This is all good stuff. I get it. I'm picking up what you're putting down. Ooh, hello. Draw four cards. So my plan is just to hoof them next turn. Just a good old good old fashioned hoofing. Oh, I think that they're actually thinking about maybe Okoing my Tracker or my Scavenging Ooze here. Okay, that's the easy part. What do you do with Oko, though? No, they're just going to make a 3-3. Okay. Sure. That way I have an unsummoning sick beast to bash with. Sun Titan. Oh man, for Oblivion Stone. So I think if I Crater Hoof, 1, 2, 3, 4, they don't have enough. They don't have enough mana. 20. So let's just do the math here. So I've got 4 creatures. I can't get any more than 4 creatures currently. So I've got 4 creatures. I play Crater Hoof. That's my 5th creature. So everything's getting +5/+5. And trample. So this is 10. Oh, this has to be easily enough. This is 10 by itself. 18. 26. 33 plus 9, 42 minus 9. Yeah, it's plenty. There's no white mana. Whatever, I'll just play this, I guess. The old math is for blockers, although this time we kind of cheated and did the math. Yeah, whatever. So, I managed to not punt that game away. Good for me. Wow. That was a close game, though. A proper game of Magic. Okay, that's a mulligan. That's a mulligan. That's a keeper. So the plan here is to bop, hit a land at some point into Oracle, and rely on that to get us to Primeval Titan. Okay, sure. Go. We're gonna have to run super hot. Really? Land. Ugh. So, going to get back sword, but can't attack this turn. Okay, I'll live with it. we hit a land off the top, I can cast Primeval Titan. Ooh, even better than hitting a land. All right, so here. Play Prime Time. Get some Landos. Oh, we missed that time. Okay. So we're going to start getting hit by a sword, but it hopefully they don't get to go like tap everything, play something, hit us, do it again. Because now I can just get rid of Secure Tribe Elder, but our Gaia's Cradle taps for literally 1,000 mana. Because we're going to draw Garrick, play it, play Deranged Hermit. Okay, but first I need to get in because I don't want Search for tomorrow, so I want to shuffle it away. All right, we even hit. So let's just say they have nothing. This only affects if it's a player, so they can get through to Garrick either way. So I'm trying to decide if I should plus so that Garrick for sure lives, or if I should minus because then if they attack Garrick, like they have to wipe the board basically. I think I should plus because I have plenty enough for lethal here anyway. And this way, if they do have a sweeper, I'll still have Garrick left over and they'll lose their Emery. If they play something like, they don't have double white, but if they play something like Wrath of God or whatever. Because if they went, let's say they went hit Garrick, Plains Wrath. Ooh, no planes. So they have to hit Garrick. I'm assuming that they're dead. I didn't do the math yet, but I'm going to pay the echo. Oh, they didn't even do that? Well, then I get to just overrun. That's nice. So I guess they could have turnabout or something stupid. Do I have lethal? Let's see. They soak up some damage here. They take 2, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9, and then 2 here. So 2, 4, 6, 8, 9, 10. It's actually exactly lethal. If I overrun, obviously, it's far more than lethal. But what if they overrun and they have, like, turnabout or something stupid? Then I lose my Garrick. If they have just, like, a bounce creature, you know, like, let's say they have Venser. Then my overrun is lethal. Yeah. We'll overrun. Do I want to not get Karn liberated here? Yeah, I want to get Karn in case this doesn't work. All right, looks like we got it. Whew. Okay. So we mulliganed to 5 and won that game against a player who went turn 1, land Sol Ring, Grim Monolith. That's pretty good. And I think I figured out why my brain misfired on the Ulamog stuff from game 1 also. I think my brain, for whatever reason, was referencing sort of Body and Mind rather than Ulamog. So I was thinking that it would mill them for 10. They had 24 cards at the time. So I think I thought, okay, mill them for 10, mill them for 10. It's not lethal anyway. So don't attack. Don't take the risk. If I would have been thinking properly, I would have actually taken the risk. And we may have lost on the spot, but I would have been more willing to take the risk because it wouldn't have mattered what they did. They had to kill us that next turn or kill Ulamog. But again, I messed it up because, I don't know, reading's hard or something. But I would have made a different play had I thought of it. But wow, we escaped with a 2-1. So now, onward to the trophy. Okay, round number two. Ooh, 41 card special. Yeah, this looks like a keeper. Needs a little bit more action because it's a little bit land heavy, but yeah, there we go. That's fine. Elves of the Llanowar Variety. And we get to play Garrick on 3. Kind of either way. What does this take? Oh, takes my Garrick. Rude. Play the Tribe Elder. So what do I want to find now? Vivian? Shoot this thing down? That would be kind of sweet. Mind Twist would be good. I'm going to get my Swamp with Secure Tribe Elder. Ooh, good colors. Good colors. Oh, yeah. All aboard the value train. Population, Kenny Darko. Swamp and an Island. Gonna make me taste it? No. That works. Beast mode, as they say. That kind of unlocks the power of Cradle here as well. So yeah, that was a very good draw. Honestly, maybe the best, like drawing a 5-drop there was just excellent. Oh, you got a Cradle too. Just leave my Garrick alone. Search, okay. Don't do it. Yeah, that part's easy. And also very important because it means that I can't minus and keep Garrick around. At this point, though, I wonder if I even want to keep Garrick around because now I can go... I can play Deranged Hermit, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5... play Cradle, have 100 mana. Now, I'm only drawing 3 cards, but I mean, I can cast a lot of stuff here. At the same time, my opponent hasn't really put any pressure up on Garrick, and I can just keep making beasts, which is pretty strong. So I guess I'll do that like a coward. I mean, it's not a bad board state. It's really not a bad board state. Nissa? Oh my god. Oh my god. I'm going to have to throw some serious business Nissa's direction here because I really can't let my opponent untap from this position. Ooh, they didn't attack. Okay, this is really good then. I am going to pay. Draw a bunch of cards. Ooh, hello. Is that enough? Do I have enough? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, yeah. Oh, we're doing it. Who needs to attack Nissa anyway? That was awesome. Whatever. Let's just run this streamlined beauty right back again. Ooh, I like where this is going. Oh man, this is a sweet opener. Am I just supposed to mind twist three of their four cards away here? I was going to play Oracle because I'm guaranteed to hit an extra land drop and then I'm basically guaranteed to get their whole hand. But it actually just feels like correct to just pounce now. Like what could they have left over that's so good, right? Because it's random also, so they don't even get to pick. And we can still have these sweet plays available to us later too. So we'll just put them down to one card. I know, I mean. Ooh, that's a nice one. Play Oracle. Hit. Hit. Yes, 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 yes. Can't do anything else though. Womp. But we're going to basically go Primeval into Ulamog here. I just don't see how we can lose. If we get to cast these spells. Now, if we don't, it's different. There are certainly ways for my opponent to come back. Yeah, like Nissa. Okay, Nissa empty is not great, but still pretty good. Just get greedy here and try to hit some more. Okay, we missed there, but that's really good too. Yeah, we're looking beautiful here. So we can Ulamog next turn, taking out a land, like a creature land in a Nissa. All right, looks like they've given up. I don't blame them. That was an absurd, like our deck just absolutely cruised both of those games. That's how we wrote it up. That's how it's supposed to go, right? Supposed to? Is that a thing? No? All right, round number three. I think this is just a mulligan. Like, we just don't do anything till turn four. It's just too much. That's obviously a mulligan. Wow, this is terrible. I think I actually... Wow, I don't remember the last time I went to four, but... Like, what does this hand do? It's a 5-drop, a 5-drop, a 10-drop, and an 8-drop with no ramp and two lands. My best case is to draw a land, play turn three tracker, and start drawing extra cards. No, I'm going to mulligan that. Yeah, see, this is nice. So what do I want to keep here? Get to keep four cards. So that's definitely going back. I definitely am keeping land, tree speaker, land. So that's three of them, and I get to keep one other card. So it's either a Gaia's Cradle or an Elder. Or I guess it could be Deranged Hermit. I could keep Forest, Tree Speaker, Cradle, Hermit. So then I go Tree Speaker. The next turn I play Cradle. I put a thing on this and I've got 1, 2, 3, 4. Then I can draw a land, play Hermit, and then have a bunch of mana. It's obviously super risky. If anything gets in the way of any of this, I just lose, basically. Hey, you're back. I mean, realistically, I probably just lose anyway, but I'm trying to up my risk here to try to, you know, get the best I can get. I'm trying to be the best I can be. I And it's kind of working. Like, our plan is to now draw land, play Deranged Hermit, and then play Karn or something. Of course, we're getting like triple manned now somehow. Yeah, you got me. Ouch. So land here is critical. If we don't draw land here, I think it's just over. Oh yeah, that's really bad. All right, well, we did hit. But it's too late probably, because this is going to kill this. And well, maybe not. Maybe not. I still have Cradle plus a whole bunch of random creatures, so it's not the end. But they really want to use Master of the Wild Hunt to kill Tree Speaker. They have so much mana available. That's 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. They have 11 mana. Okay, well, Vivian Reed actually doesn't do anything to my board, so that's lucky. Okay, there's a land. This is turn 4, by the way. I was kind of hoping that my opponent would maybe have a slower draw since I mulled to 4, but instead they're just dropping the absolute hammer. Turn 3, Nissa who shakes the world off of Raphelos. Oh, but wait, there's more. Oh, good, good, yes. Wall of Roots, sweet. Do more. Yeah, let's just keep that, keep all that stuff coming. Let's just do more. I'm just taking this. Because if I block with the squirrels, then they can kill my Deranged Hermit and things get awkward. Oh yeah, there's more. Yeah, do that. Okay, now they're going to kill Tree Speaker, which is fine. I need to draw another land to be able to play Karn. Sweet. I wouldn't say I'm in a good position, but we did get to at least do things. Mm-hmm. Hey, look, it's our deck. Are they just going to get the tracker, or do they find something better? They got Acidic Slime to kill my Cradle. Yeah, that should do it. There's no way out now. Not with the old slime ball in there. And since this Cradle isn't going to do anything anymore anyway, I may as well get some value from these stupid squirrels. Now they should just blow up a forest, though. Because the cradle doesn't actually count anymore. All right, I'm going to scoop. I'll see what we draw. Yeah, I'll scoop. All right. So it turns out I'm only getting to four. Bad plan. Real bad plan. So let's not do that anymore. I think I want Pelucranos of all things. And Beast Within. Yeah, let's bring in some really bad cards. Oh, yeah. What should I cut? Scavenging news? Sure. Okay. Need a better draw than the old mold of four. But we can go toe-to-toe with this deck. Our deck is every bit as fast. Although they do have Raffellos. Yeah, this is probably fine. No one drop, which is a bit annoying. But we can library on turn two and then Zenith on three if we need to. And they suspended search. With Basalt Monolith, it's probably better to just hold on to Zenith and go for a like a Primeval Titan or something. What could we get? Nothing good. But Primeval Titan next turn's good. Jeez. Man, hitting that land was nice. Ooh, Channel Mindslaver? I want to have something on the battlefield before I Mindslaver. So I can at least run one of their creatures into my prime time or something. Acidic Slime's on top of the library. I guess that is a good thing to blow up here. So yeah, unless if they draw a card here, then they can just kind of have their way. But if they don't, then going for the Mindslaver is very good. Because I can Acidic Slime one of their things. Like, for example, that. so this elf is going to get in. But I'm not going to get decked out by the thing. Wow, all my good stuff, though? Okay. Okay, how much mana do I actually have here? I have 5, 6, 7. I need 10 total, but I can actually make a little bit more, so I can play a bird for free with Cradle, Channel, and then I can just play Slaver and then just channel for 4 to crack it. Sweet. Wow. Okay. Yeah, I wasn't sure. I think this put us pretty close to winning, but then the next turn, because then my plan was to kill either this or this or this. I haven't decided yet, but to probably kill one of these two by running them into Primeval Titan, play their own Acidic Slime, blow up Sword of Body and Mind. Then on my turn, I can go Tireless Tracker, attack with Primeval Titan. Get it trades off, but I get two more lands plus the tracker triggers, so I can kind of go off. So the question then is, do I need Nature's Claim? Because I do have Vivian Reed, although I took her out, didn't I? Interesting. Well, I think I want Vivian Reed instead of Garrick then. She can serve a similar role of providing card advantage, but also blow up a sword. The question is, do I want the Nature's Claim in addition? God, I really don't want to get stuck with that thing in my hand with no target. I think I'm just going to run what I brung. This looks fine. Not a great hand, but an okay one. If I draw a 4-drop here, I'm in business. Okay, so there's a thing I can destroy with Vivian, but it's not till next turn. Okay, that works too. Library fight. Love it, love it, love it. I'm like that too. I'm very aggressive with my library. Okay. This is all business. So, how big of a deal is Sylvan Library on the other side? Because I could kill Courser, right? Enchantment. And that would leave my opponent with a grand total of 1 power and without the ability to attack Vivian effectively, but with Sylvan Library rolling. They're similar in that they're kind of card advantage. They work really well together as well. So if I kill the library, the courser's a lot worse, but they just attack courser into Vivian Reed and kill her immediately. I think I'm going to gamble a little here. And blow up the courser. This kind of forces my opponent's hand. Like, they can pump up Incubation Druid to kill Vivian Reed, but that's like their whole hand. That's their whole turn. We get to untap and play Primeval Titan and then go right into Ulamog. Like, if we tempo them out for one turn like that, that could be enough right there. Because obviously if we get to stick Ulamog, the game's probably over at that point. There's also the chance that they just wanted to pump Incubation Druid anyway, but... Ooh, Black Lotus. Man, opponent's got a deck. Wow, these R2 decks are both very, very strong. Nissa, oh! Such a sick turn. Oh my god, Nissa off of Black Lotus and Tree Speaker. They get to just dump their whole hand. Unbelievable. Nine mana? Green Sun? For an 8-ball. Terastodon? Woodfall. Blow up library. Okay, that's fine. I mean, it's not good. Like, we're going to lose now, but that was a sick turn from our opponent. I mean, it took a turn like that to get to this position. Right, so Ulamog's still on top. Well... I can't have both, so I may as well cast Primeval Titan here. Unfortunately, it shuffles away Ulamog. But if I only cast Basalt Monolith, then I can't cast Ulamog anyway. I would be close. I would have 9 mana, but my draw step would have to be Ulamog for the turn, which it would be, but that, of course, means that it's not a land. I mean, Primeval Titan's a good card. And we can make infinite mana, but I just need to get lucky. I just need to rip, like, Craterhoof or Ulamog or something like that, because I can go Deranged Hermit and then Cradle makes 5 or 7 or whatever mana. But I don't think I'm losing this turn unless they have Craterhoof. But I'm probably losing the next turn regardless. So it's like one of those spots where I'm in really bad shape. I'm not going to block the Woodfall. Because I need the Cradle to stay on the battlefield. Because I'm going to have to get extraordinarily lucky here to win. But part of the equation is having access to just obscene amounts of mana. They redrew Green Sun Zenith, okay. What are you going to get? Avenger? Could just get Acidic Slime. They paid 7, but they could just... You can get or less. So I think them getting Cradle off the battlefield kind of does me in. Because they are so far ahead right now. Well, they got their own Primeval Titan. That works too. Yeah, we're very, very dead now. I don't think they've even used Nissa yet. Forest. Staying alive. Oh, what? Oh, that thing. Okay, sure. So I have to figure out how much damage I can take and assume that probably Craterhoof is my out here. Mm-hmm. I still got plenty of mana even if they blow up my Cradle. Now they're going to hoof me. Man, I thought our deck was good. This is insanity. Oh, Reckless Age, sure. Paul, huh? That is embarrassing. Still could have ripped Craterhoof. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. That would have been lethal, I'm pretty sure. At least close to it. So are we going to see an ultimate here, or what's the plan? Yeah, ultimate. So these are indestructible. And we're going to see all the rest of the forest come out. But these are the only ones that are indestructible. Questy B. So we're going to see a huge attack here. Definitely these want to come in. But they kind of need to be accompanied by the big hitters to make it worth it. I'm going to shuffle away the Questing Beast? No. So I can just take this, though. But I should probably not. Actually, I probably should just take it. Block like that. I take 12. I go to 2. All right. And now I can't actually fight this anymore. Now we're dead. That was a good game. We needed to get pretty lucky down this stretch, though, after our opponent had that Black Lotus turn. I mean, come on. Their deck is just completely absurd. All right. GG's. All right, so we had to settle for a 2-1 with this thing. Right? Is that what we ended up with? Yeah, 2-1. So, not too bad. That was definitely a 3-0 quality deck, but we ran into a 4-0 quality deck there at the end. Their deck was just off the charts. The Black Lotus in there, too, and Nissa was insane in that deck. We would have loved a Nissa, too. That is going to do it for this one. I want to remind you that these videos are brought to you by Channel Fireball, so check them out for all things Magic-related. And you can find me on social media, Marshall_LR, and everything related to the podcast I do with Luis Scott Vargas every week called Limited Resources at lrcast.com. We'll see you next time.